Good evening, I'm Lisa Lord, and in our news, three died tragically in an apartment building fire. A new tool to fight vector-borne diseases like Zika. Calypsonians draw for Picardy Crop final positions. And in sports, the BOA launches a new fundraiser for the one-year mark before Tokyo 2020.
Broadcasting from our studio in the Pine St. Michael, this is CBC Newsnight, starting now.
And we begin our news with some very sad news. A tragic fire in Warrens this morning has claimed three lives. Lisa Broom is on the scene and joins us live now. And Lisa, dreadful just does not begin to describe what happened there today, does it?
You're so right, Lisa. It really was a terrible scene. And you know, it's always bad when people lose their lives. But the situation is made even worse when children are involved in a tragedy like this.
This video, shot from across the road in the area of Simpson Motors, shows the flames billowing from this ground-level apartment at number 93 Regency Drive, Warrens Park South. It was just before midday that people in the area raised the alarm, calling the fire service and police. Public Relations Officer Inspector Rodney Innes says they received a call around a quarter to 12. By the time CBC arrived on the scene, firemen had put out the blaze, and we learnt the unthinkable. Three people had perished inside.
On arrival, they met the fire service. There were three tenders from the fire service who responded. And on further investigations, after the fire was brought under control, it was revealed that, unfortunately, the bodies of three individuals, one male, one adult male, and two infants.
At least two residents who did not want to go on camera reported they heard a loud explosion before smelling smoke. One woman said it was actually her two toddlers who alerted her the apartment building was on fire. Richard Haynes, who operates a barbershop nearby, says he was cutting the hair of a woman who lives in the same apartment building. He says they went over to see what they could save from that burning building.
I tell her in these words, just be calm. Just be calm. And We stand up here. We actually observe what's going on. Then we hear some feedback, but the house was, they had a low explosion in the back.
Well, Lisa, we've since learned that the man who died in the blaze is Cornelius Barrow, an English teacher at Coleridge and Parry Secondary School, and the two infants are his children. The Ministry of Education has expressed its regret at his death, and it has organized counseling for staff and students at the school tomorrow, Thursday, at 10 a.m. Back to you, Lisa.
Thank you so much, Lisa. Well, the Ministry of Health is moving to prevent a resurgence in Zika and other vector-borne diseases. As Lorna Jones reports, a new tool has been added to the fight, which should benefit the entire region. We get more in this report.
The island's first insectary in a box, located near the Graham Hall Swamp, has now officially been handed over by the United States Agency for International Development, or USAID. The insectary is a lab which will be used to perform and analyze research on the local mosquito population with the aim of improving vector control.
Public health threats do not respect borders, territorial waters, and not even sovereignty. So I hope that by having the insectary here and the training that is going to be provided, that not only our country, but our neighbors would also be able to strengthen their programs.
USAID, through the Zika AIRS Project, or ZAP, also seeks to bring about social change through education at the household level. However, Minister Bostic notes that some vector control efforts employed by householders may have a negative effect.
Some private sector companies have entered the market offering space spraying with newer insecticides. However, this action can rapidly provoke insecticide resistance and therefore requires constant monitoring. In this regard, We work closely with the reference lab at the Caribbean Public Health Agency, CARFA, the only facility at this time in the region where insecticide resistance testing is currently available.
ZAPS Director of Project Operation, Kate Stillman, says the insectary will be integral to the regional response.
To control the mosquito, we must know the mosquito. So an insectary is in a very important part of the overall infrastructure and system to support an integrated approach. This insectary will be an important element of the Ministry of Health and Wellness's system to do so going forward.
The ZAP program operates through 6 countries in the region. Lorna Jones, CBC News.
In news from the Senate now, Leader of Government Business, Senator Dr. Jerome Walcott, says government is looking to bring more housing solutions to the parish of St. Lucie. He was leading off a resolution on the vesting of land at Colleton Plantation in that parish in the National Housing Corporation.
It is expected that it will provide housing development to produce 79 lots and 7 duplexes. And the process in terms of the acquisition has gone through the relevant issues in terms of in accordance with the provisions of Section 5 of the Crown Lands Vesting and Disposable Act.
All is in place for next Friday's Pickety Crop Finals. Our Shane Jones was at Kensington Oval this evening for that draw.
The gate positions have been chosen and the big horses for next Friday's Calypso Derby are ready to go. Appearing at number 1 is Sammy Jane, followed by Sammy Dello. Faith is at number 3, then Iron Lady TC is at 4. First-timer Eric Lewis performing as Granny will be at 5, and after him, the defending monarch Mr. Blood is at 6. Terry makes her Pickety Crop Finals debut at number 7, ahead of the 2017 runner-up Edwin Yearwood. Perennial finalist Crystal Cummins Beckles Holder rounds out the first half. Miss Sammy G starts the show in the second half at 10, followed by Jay Slow at 11, and two-time King AC at 12. Donella is at 13, followed by Tentmate Kidsight. 2015 Monarch Classic is at number 15, and Mr. Dale makes a return to the final stage at 16. Ramesses has been having a fantastic season. He's at position number 17, and Jude completes the list of 18. Eric Lewis says he's happy with number 5.
I've drawn position number 5. I was born on the 5th day of the 5th month, so hopefully, but don't count faith, hopefully I'll win. But generally, I'm happy with the position which I've drawn, and I'm happy with what I'm working towards in terms of presentation and getting myself ready for the competition.
2017 Junior Monarch Terry says she's not intimidated because she's the youngest in the final.
It doesn't faze me. As I said, I'm not scared. I know that all I have to do is come and show people that I'm worth watching, I'm worth being in this final, and that's all I'm trying to do.
Crystal Cummins Beckles plans to give her best.
Just give a good representation of myself, represent my tent, and of course the women in Calypso and the women of Barbados.
The Pickety Crop Final will be held next Friday night at Kensington Oval. Shane Jones, CBC News.
Well, 3 shows all in one. That's what the organizers of Rise Together are promising patrons come July 31st. Marketing and communications manager DeCarla Applewhite says that patrons will be treated to the best of Cropover, and that's an all-star DJ cast and the best from across the region. The event was launched last evening in the presence of sponsors and artists. 98.1 The One and MultiChoice Television are among the sponsors for the Rise Together.
We promise a cast of royalty, soca royalty. We have 6 kings alone from Barbados. We have the international bashment soca monarch, King Bubba. We have Little Rick, Stiffy, Edwin Yearwood, Red Plastic Bag, and Mikey. Bashment, sweet soca, party monarch, Pickety Crop. This is the pick of the shows for the season.
And the organizers of Rise are partnering up with the Precious Touch Foundation this year. The organization grants wishes to children with life-threatening illnesses. The most popular wish category, of course, is to travel to Disney World.
Sign up today to catch all the major Cropover events live online on cropover.cbc.bb. We've got you covered. Soca Monarch Finals, $53 or $26. Pick of the Crop Finals, $62 or $30. And Grand Cadument, $22 or $11. Don't be left out. Log on now to cropover.cbc.bb and book. CBC, taking crop over to the world.
Regional stories now, and the Economic Commission for Latin America and the Caribbean is not predicting any significant growth for the region. Deputy Director of ECLAC, Dr. Dylan Allen, says since the global crisis of 2008-2009, economies in the region have not returned to pre-crisis economic growth. Now, with the exception of Guyana, commodity producers have been dealing with a drop in prices and foreign exchange shortages. However, Dr. Allen says service-oriented countries have been doing better.
Tourism inflows have been significant, consequent on the extraordinary expansion in the U.S. economy, mostly, and so they have done a little better. But ECLAC projects that on the basis of the current configuration of industries and sectors, growth is going to be modest.
Midwives stationed in Guyana's hinterland communities are being encouraged by Minister of Public Health Walter Lawrence to make use of public health facilities and institutions to perform deliveries. The minister wants to ensure safe pregnancies, as we hear from NTN.
We're encouraging what we would call the midwives in the various villages, you know. We're inviting them to be part of the system. We want them to be able to bring their clients to the health center where it's a safe, it's hygienic, and so on, so they can have their birthing, and we're going to provide the instruments and so on that they would use.
To address the issue of unplanned pregnancy, the minister said her ministry is ensuring that health facilities are equipped with contraceptives.
So we have found that more women are coming forward to have the IUD that they put in the arm, so we decided to buy more, and our partners have supported us on that. Last year alone, we distributed over 900, and this year we are doubling up.
It was also revealed that the Public Health Ministry will continue to work in the hinterland communities to reduce cases of teenage pregnancy through a multi-stakeholder approach.
History was made in Dominica when 22-year-old Lorenzo Sanford was elected the new Kalinago chief. His aim is to improve the Kalinago territory. We have a report from Marpin TV.
Preliminary results placed him ahead of Annette Sanford, 409-406. He managed to maintain his lead on Tuesday. Lorenzo, a graduate of the Dominica State College, is only 22.
And I would like to thank God for guiding me and thank for my supporters who were there all throughout since I started. And thank you for my elders who prayed for me, who guided me along the way. And when it comes to the Kalinago chief and the elections, I have a very comprehensive plan in place, and I would like to ensure that when my counselors come through with me, that we can all sit together and work together in bringing the Kalinago territory forward.
There is an expectation that with the new chief, there will be greater collaboration with central government.
I would like to be working with central government to improve our Kalinago community, because when it comes to the Kalinago territory, we have not been working with the central government as we have seen in the past, and this have held us back a lot. But I will be willing to work with the central government.
Lorenzo is appealing to his people, including the other candidates, to work with him to develop their community.